The Portfolio Composer, episode 209.
You're listening to the Portfolio Composer podcast with your host and coach, Garrett Hope, where he teaches you what it takes to master the business end of writing music through mindset, marketing, and business skills. Make sure to sign up for the newsletter at theportfoliocomposer.com for exclusive offers, business insights, and information not shared on the podcast. And now, for this episode of The Portfolio Composer.
It was just putting the idea out. And because ultimately it was a good idea, one that, you know, New York needed at that time, because nobody was playing hide and knockers. So that's the way it came about. So I think you have to marry your own passion with what the world seems to need or want or could want, and try to find some place for it.
This episode is brought to you by Dorico, the music notation software from Steinberg. Just released, Dorico Pro 2 is a major new version, including features for musicians working in film and TV music and in jazz, rock, and pop. Steinberg have also released Dorico Elements, a new entry-level application that packs all of the essential power of Dorico Pro into a simple, streamlined package that is ideal for those getting started. Find out more later in the show. Hello, and welcome to episode 209 of the Portfolio Composer Podcast. I am your host, your coach, your teacher, Garrett Hope, and I am so grateful that you're taking the time to listen. If you get any value out of this, spread the word, share it with someone who you think could benefit from the insights gained in these episodes, in these interviews, because I do this to help composers and creatives figure out what it means to build a career in the 21st century. And this is a powerful way to do it by looking at people who are succeeding at that endeavor. Today's episode is with conductor Roger Nierenberg. Maestro Nierenberg is the creator of the music paradigm. The music paradigm is a powerful learning experience that uses symphonic music to illuminate compelling insights about people at work. Participants are seated directly amongst the orchestra musicians, where they gain fresh understandings about the opportunities and challenges faced by their own organization. Over the past 20 years, Nierenberg has presented to hundreds of different organizations. And what's really cool about this is that Maestro Nierenberg has been able to take his music expertise and apply that directly to the business world to help these business leaders lead better. I hope you get a lot out of this. Enjoy. Roger, tell me, how did you become a conductor to start with?
Well, when I graduated high school, I considered myself a composer, and I had taken private composition lessons with Ellie Siegmeister through junior high school and high school. And then I went to Princeton University as a composer, and I didn't really have any idea that I was going to do anything other than composition. But during my college years, first of all, I loved conducting, and I had done some even in high school, both choral and orchestral. And I continued conducting my own works while I was in high school. But I thought that since making a career in music is a very challenging thing, I wanted to do that thing that I felt like I had the most immediate kind of talent for. And that was conducting. I thought my talent as a conductor was greater than my talent as a composer. So when I graduated college, I started pursuing an orchestral conducting career.
Oh, wow. So just like that.
Yes.
And so you probably didn't make the big leap from graduating college to having the podium of an orchestra. What happened next?
Well, then I kind of bumped up right against the real world. It was a kind of a rude shock for me. It was just, I think it was took a tremendous amount of entrepreneurial energy in order to get my career started. But finally I did. And the first professional position that I had was as music director of a fine amateur chorus that engaged professional orchestras and performed in New York. And that was my first job. Then, while I had that job, I entered the Juilliard School in the graduate program in conducting, and that kind of opened my eyes up to many things because I had never gone to a conservatory. And I had great conducting experiences at Juilliard. I had my own orchestra, which was the pre-college orchestra, the high school orchestra, and there were many great musicians in that orchestra, really great musicians who are famous musicians today. And then I got another job as the music director of the Stamford Symphony. And then a couple of years later, the Jacksonville Symphony in Florida. And then I had a career as a conductor. That was what I was doing all the time. I had two orchestras and doing concerts and rehearsals. That was my life.
You make it sound so easy.
Well, it was not easy.
I imagine, in particular, because you said you hit a wall and it took entrepreneurial spirit to kind of build your career.
It certainly did.
Can you expand on that? What does that mean?
I think it means, first of all, that you have to be proactive. You can't expect things to come to you, because it just dawned on me that nothing was coming to me. There was absolutely nobody knocking on my door. And because of the education I had more connections in the world of composers than I did in the world of orchestras. So I really had nothing.
But composers don't commission composers.
No. So I sought advice and I wrote letters. I wrote lots of letters to managers. And eventually I found a tiny little opening and I managed to get an interview for my first job. It happened mostly through just persistence and continually writing and talking to people and asking advice. I was very discouraged. I was incredibly discouraged. I would have been very surprised at that time to learn that the stuff that I was doing actually was having a positive effect, because it felt like it was having none.
So what kept you in the game? Why didn't you quit?
I really loved making music. I really loved conducting. That was what I wanted to do. That was stronger than the force of discouragement, which was plenty strong. But the love of music and of making music, and underneath all of the doubt, there was a kind of belief in myself. Eventually, that had an effect.
Yeah. I love how you describe having a passion that overrode any sense of struggle.
Yeah, well, there was plenty of struggle and there was plenty of discouragement. That was what my life was about for a number of years.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't very happy during that time, but eventually things changed.
So what kind of advice do you give to students or people emerging onto their careers about being persistent and pushing through? And when should a person make the choice to quit or back off?
Well, I think you should make the choice to quit and back off immediately if you can. I just couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. And Elie Sigmeister, who was my teacher while I was in junior high school and high school, used to say music is only for people who are so crazy about it that they can't do anything else. And I was one of them.
As you were putting yourself out in the world and teaching yourself how to network, essentially, and communicate and write letters, and you started getting positions, how did the skills you were learning in these entrepreneurial endeavors translate into your conducting?
I think conductors need to be very entrepreneurial. You need to have a couple of projects that you really believe in and a contribution that you want to make. You know, just what is it that really inspires you the most, and try to organize that into some way of fitting into what the world needs. So at one point, somebody suggested to me, look into the Haydn operas. There's some interest in Haydn. So I networked. At the time, I was teaching theory at Queen's College, and on the faculty was a man who knew H.C. Robbins Landon. And Landon was coming to New York to do a Haydn and Stravinsky festival. And I arranged to have a breakfast with him and with my colleague. And he said, do L'Inferno del Cadeluza. That's the one you should definitely do. No question about that. So I went to the direction of the Mostly Mozart Festival, for whom I had trained the chorus. And so they knew who I was. And I suggested to them that I wanted to do this Haydn opera. They said, we can't do that. That's impossible. We can't do that. And I said to him, I'm not asking you to put it on. I'm asking for advice about how to put it on. And he gave me some impractical advice. And so months and months and months passed, and nothing happened, until one day I got a call from the Mostly Mozart Festival saying, we want to engage you to do this opera. So it was an example of how, had there not been the pedigree of H.C. Robbins Landon behind the idea, it would not have been taken seriously. And so that was an important part. But it was just putting the idea out. And because ultimately it was a good idea, one that, you know, New York needed at that time, because nobody was playing Haydn operas. So that's the way it came about. I think you have to marry your own passion with what the world seems to need or want or could want, and try to find some place for it.
That's a lovely, lovely statement. I love that. You need to marry your passion with the needs of the world.
Yeah, even though the world may not realize that it needs your passion yet, but you have to find a way of kind of proving that it does.
Yeah, I agree 100%. So tell us about what you're doing nowadays.
Well, my career has taken a number of, how would I say, changes of direction at various times, mostly through inspiration. And at a certain time in the 90s, it just dawned on me. I can tell the story. I went to the CEO of a company where one of my orchestras was in the hopes of getting him interested in supporting the symphony in some way. And he said to me, "You got a really difficult marketing problem." And I had no idea what he was talking about because I was not a marketer. I didn't do marketing. He said, "People like me, you know, we consider ourselves intelligent. We're well educated. We're curious people. But we walk into your concert hall and we can't read the program. We don't know what it means. We don't know what to do. We don't know what to clap. We don't feel very intelligent. We don't, and it's not a very comfortable feeling, and we don't like it, and we don't have to have it, and we don't." That's your problem. So I really felt like I was in the enemy camp there. I felt very uncomfortable, but it kind of stuck with me. And the more I thought about it, the more I realized that that was one of the big problems in the music field. There were so many great musicians, but there wasn't enough audience. There just wasn't enough audience to support musicians comfortably without them having to periodically face crises that threatened their employment. And I began to think about that. And my challenge was, this guy who was sitting in his office with me, was there a way to get him really interested in music? I wondered, because the signs were clear that there was none. But I challenged myself in that. I was always experimenting, and I'm a kind of a natural educator, or I'd say a teacher, you know, and I love to share. And I was always experimenting with new ways of sharing music. And through it all, I kind of invented a way to create an environment where anybody could not only get interested in, but actually feel music the way that I feel it. And I tried it out, and it worked. It was incredible.
This episode is sponsored by Dorico, the future of scoring. And we want to feature real Dorico users so you can know that real composers out in the world today are using Dorico to make their careers happen.
My name is Dan Kreider. I'm a full-time church musician. So I'm typically making lead sheets is the majority of what I do. But I also arrange for just a diversity of instruments, a lot of instrumentation for full orchestra, sometimes a string group, sometimes next Sunday we're having a brass quartet. It's a pretty active schedule, always writing on deadline, always trying to get it done. Most people have something that they're using, and unless they're really fed up with it, they have a workflow, they're accustomed to it, and they like what they know. And in some cases, they perhaps don't realize what something could be. And that, I think, was my case. I had amassed a huge collection of workarounds and third-party plugins and shortcuts. And I had just become accustomed to thinking that was fine and normal. And it just vaguely started to annoy me that once I had finished the creative part of a score, I knew there were 2 hours ahead of me or so to get it looking like it needed to be. And that's honestly what sort of overcame that original entrenchment. You initially maybe adopt a program because of a particular reason, and then you find there's another reason you hadn't even considered. I initially came to Dorico from Finale only because I was tired of tweaking a score and tired of avoiding collisions. But I had not even considered something like non-destructive writing. And also just the output is bold and strong and feels very personal. Those are things that I was pleasantly surprised at. What I love most about it is that scores look beautiful right out of the box. Honestly, that is what I love the most. I can open up the score. I can start entering the notes. I can switch over to engrave mode to check it. I may bump one or two little things, and it's done. I never have to settle for ugly scores again on short notice. I think one of the things that I really appreciate about the development process and that I think is going to yield the best results in the long run is that everything is so carefully thought through. In another 6 months to a year, the number of things that Dorico won't do natively is going to be a fraction of what people are going to require of it. There's really no question that I'd recommend it. In fact, I do, and my colleagues give me a kind of a hard time about it, jokingly, because I'm a little bit of an evangelist. I have started offering private tutoring. That's a real interest of mine in helping users, you know, ask questions and evaluate their own workflow and see, okay, there are some other ways that I could really trim down my time and get to the real business, which is making music.
The kind folks at Dorico have set up a special webpage so you can go and download a free 30-day trial copy of Dorico. So go and do that. I have been using the program and I'm absolutely in love with it. Go to dorico.com/TPC. I want to know what you did to solve the marketing problem that you discovered you had.
I never adequately solved it.
Ah.
I mean, I did not even attempt to market to that guy. I left marketing to the marketers.
Sure.
That was the way I saw it at that time.
Got it. Okay, so you're having this epiphany and you want to start sharing the experience that you have with others. So what happened next?
I mean, I feel music very deeply and it's very important to me. And I was just curious, was there a way that you could present music in such a way as to give other people that feeling that I had, which in a way is kind of very ambitious. But that's what I was exploring. And I was thinking about it all the time. And then I came up with this kind of learning environment. It wasn't a concert, but it was a learning environment where if people were in the room, they would feel what I felt. That was what I was looking to do. And when I tried it out, it was more successful than I could imagine.
And what does that actually look like?
Well, I'm not sure where to begin. First of all, the normal way that you do music appreciation is you try to build a bridge from the music to your audience and you deliver the music across that bridge. I didn't believe in that because I thought in a way the medium was the message. That the medium was that we have this thing, we know about it, and we're going to give it to you. And I thought that that killed the possibility of bringing about what I was trying to do. So I thought, what would it be like if your starting point is where they live and what's important to them? And somehow you bring music into that world. Because when, as music director, I would periodically give talks at the Rotary Club or other kinds of businessmen's clubs. And I discovered that when I talked about the upcoming program, the music, the guest artists and all, they politely listened. And when I talked about the orchestra as a community institution and what it would do for the economic development of the community, they listened with somewhat more interest. But when I talked about my job, that was more than polite listening. They really wanted to know about my job. And I began to conceive of a way of delivering music through that fascination with the conductor's job as a way of using that interest to get them to open up their ears and their spirits to what was going to happen. So the model that I eventually arrived at was that this takes place not in a concert, but it takes place in the workplace. And the agenda is not about music. The agenda is about helping people's careers. Because what are they interested in more than their careers? Everybody's interested in their careers. Mm. And if you start off with that interest and you say that this is an exercise, you don't say that, well, actually in my sessions, I do say, you know, what if, because there's a live orchestra, you know, with all these business executives sitting amongst them. And I say, what if you thought of this orchestra not as a musical ensemble, but rather a kind of collection of professional people that have this very special competitive advantage due to their ability to work in teams, their ability to lead successfully, their ability to satisfy their customers, whatever it is that that organization happens to really care about. So you want to find out what is the competitive advantage? What do the musicians have that you could transplant into your own professional life and thereby bring greater prosperity not only to yourself, but to all who work with you. And you're going to spy on the orchestra. So the whole premise is it's about being more successful in their careers. At least initially, that's the premise. And through that bridge, then I begin to deliver a kind of a music appreciation look at the orchestra. But I don't talk about music appreciation at all. I'm showing them things that they could, through analogy, kind of relate to themselves. And I display many things about the orchestra And I also display some of the dysfunctions that can happen in the orchestra. And I tailor it in such a way that these dysfunctions that I'm asking the musicians to spontaneously model, they just happen to be the very same dysfunctions that are happening in that organization. And so by listening to the orchestra, they begin to see it as a mirror of what's going on in their own professional lives. And it just got incredibly powerful. What I discovered was, it doesn't really matter why you listen to music, just as long as you listen to it with real, active, curious ears that are not blocked off by ideas and thoughts, but just as an experience. If people did that, then the music could reach them because they weren't defending themselves against the music. And their conscious minds, which tend to be the things that prevent people from hearing, they were all kind of engaged in thinking about their career. So they weren't going to get in the way. And that left the audience in a position where they could hear and feel in ways that they'd never known how to do before.
I think it's brilliant. And I don't know how intentional you were in this, but to use marketing language, you clearly identified an audience, and then you identified the needs and desires of that audience, and now you're actually helping these people get what they want, and you identified that as career development and vocational growth. And so you're also, at the same time, delivering to them these enrichment experiences through music.
Yeah, and of course, that's the part that I really care about.
Right, yeah.
But nobody's going to pay an orchestra to come to their business meeting for that.
No.
They're not interested in art. They're interested in business success.
Yes.
And they're under a lot of pressure to produce it. It's very competitive and it's very disruptive and things are changing and they have to figure out what's going to be our approach to do it. Well, when their approach is revealed to them in this way, well, let's say it's reinforced by what happens with the orchestra, it really reaches them very deeply. And that's the reason that I now have kind of a second career doing this.
And is that what you call the music paradigm? Is that your program?
That is the music paradigm.
Awesome. Where can people go to learn more about the music program?
Well, there's a website called musicparadigm.com. And there are blogs that I wrote, and there are some videos and photographs, and there's quite a lot on the website. Gives you some idea, but it can't really be captured except through direct experience.
Yeah. So your primary audience, so to speak, the people you're selling this program to, are going to be large businesses, businesses with enough revenue that they can afford to bring an orchestra in for this kind of training experience.
Yeah, by and large, but there are also some smaller organizations that do it too.
How do you market the music paradigm?
Well, I've already admitted that I'm not a good marketer. It's through word of mouth.
Sure.
It's just that it makes such an impression that people talk about it and then the telephone rings.
There you go. That's the best kind of advertising.
Yeah. Well, I'd love to figure out a more efficient way to do it, but I haven't yet because it's kind of difficult to explain. It's easy to absorb when you're there, but it's very difficult because it transcends language. You explain what happens and it doesn't sound all that great, doesn't sound all that important. But when you're in the room with it, it has real impact. Mm-hmm. There are things that I know that I do to kind of soften people up. I keep it lighthearted. There's humor in it. There's no joke telling, but there is humor. And so it's a very kind of relaxed atmosphere. But at the same time, it's also very dramatic because it's unscripted, you know? Nobody knows what's going to happen, and nobody knows who's going to be called on. And I called on all kinds of people, people in the last row of the room. They get the microphone, and they get to answer the questions that I put to them. So that's rather confrontational, but it's very friendly. It's incredibly nice, and nobody ever looks bad. All those things are a part of what makes it successful.
Well, clearly you're doing a great job and giving people meaningful experiences and business training, too.
Yeah, I think the feedback that I get is that this was very effective.
Wow, that's great. So what I really like about this, Roger, is that you found a way to add another income-producing activity into your portfolio of activities as a creative individual and as a musician. And like I explained to you earlier, I think that that is something that we need to aim for in today's job market, where having the idea of a full-time job, there's just fewer and fewer of them. And so I want to encourage the people who are listening to think about how you can meet the needs and desires of a wide variety of people like Roger has done, because you have a skill set and insights that other people need. Just like Roger said, he found a way to blend passion and the needs of the world and putting it in one place. So Roger, let me turn that question on you. What advice do you have for people who are trying to find that intersection of passion and needs?
Well, it's a good question. I think first and foremost, follow your inspiration and your curiosity and don't judge it, because there's so much judgment, you know, and normally negative judgment. And there are stereotypes and stereotypes of what is a business person and what is an artist, you know, and how the two never have anything to do with each other. That's just a judgment. It has no reality. It's an opinion, and it's an ill-informed opinion. But we have all those kinds of judgments and prejudices in our unconscious minds. And sometimes you allow those prejudices to interfere with your own curiosity and inspiration. And because as a composer, I knew that, you know, the most valuable thing to me was an inspiration, that there was the shape of a melody, or there was a harmony or a series of harmonies, or some rhythmic idea, or some kind of idea for a climax, or some seed from which the piece grows. Stravinsky said that the first thing he composed was always the tempo. The first thing you feel might be just the tempo. You don't know what's inside the tempo, but you know what that tempo is. So I knew that following my inspiration was really important. And I was kind of trained to do that. So I just allowed it to go. And then I made use of the various things that there were in my life, the people who were in my life and the people that I knew. Now, I was music director of two orchestras, so I knew quite a few people. And I had exposure to a lot of thinking, a lot of ideas. So I think, number one, follow your inspiration. It can be inspiration about ideas, and it can be inspiration about people. I think following the people that inspire you is really important. And I actually got a lot of inspiration from business people. It wasn't musical inspiration, but it was inspiration about a kind of can-do attitude, about getting people to work together well, to get people more engaged, all that kind of thing. I found a lot of inspiration in that. So I think that's really important also.
I think it's great. Roger, thank you so much for sharing with us today about the music paradigm and what you're doing. I think it's brilliant, and I find it very inspirational.
One more thing I didn't mention.
Yeah.
People want to understand it better. There's a book that I wrote about it. It's called Maestro, A Surprising Story About Leading by Listening. I think it's the best guide. It reads kind of like a fable. It's a story. It explains a lot about it and a lot of the ideas.
Excellent. I will be sure to put a link to that book in the show notes page, too.
Yeah, and then if they have ideas or questions, they can write to me via the website, musicparadigm.com.
Wonderful. All right. Thank you so much, Roger.
Well, thank you, and thank you for the work that you're doing.
This episode of The Portfolio Composer has been supported by Dorico, the music notation software from Steinberg. Whether you're a composer or arranger, a teacher or student, working in music engraving and publishing, or working in producing music for media such as film, TV, and games, Dorico is the tool for you. Dorico comes in two versions, Dorico Pro for professionals and Dorico Elements, providing the perfect introduction to the world of scoring. Whichever version you choose, you'll be using software packed full of smart features that produces beautiful results completely automatically, allowing you to get music on the stand more quickly than with any other software. You can bring music into Dorico from your existing software using Music XML or MIDI, and you can try Dorico out completely free of charge for 30 days by downloading a trial version from dorico.com/TPC. Try it today.